really excited to bring to you today's installment of the Britt Technology Impact Series with Chris O'Neill, alum back here this weekend celebrating his reunion weekend.
Yes.
Chris is the CEO of Evernote, and he is going to talk a little bit about sort of the challenges and the excitement about kind of transforming that company and maintaining its wonderful brand and shepherding that company forward. And you know, given our focus this year on digital customers and the challenges that they can present and the opportunities they present, this is a big challenge and a big opportunity for them. So please welcome Chris O'Neill to talk.
All right. Thanks, Patrick. How's everyone doing?
Good.
It's so great to be back. It's 15 years. Like, it sounds like I'm officially old now when you say I haven't gone for 15 years, but it feels like yesterday that I was here. I was back for my fifth year reunion, and it was great to see lots of my classmates and then take part in some of the classroom activities. And it's transformed even in those 5 years and then subsequent 10 years. Like, you know, there's lots of other new awesome things that I'm looking forward to exploring while I'm up here. But so it's been a great ride in those 15 years. So who remembers, who was around during the first dot-com kind of frothy times? Who remembers that? Okay. So Jack, you were not. My son and my wife, my beautiful wife and daughter are here too. He definitely was not around during the first dot-com. So I came to Tuck in 1999, and I'd previously moved to the Bay Area in 1998. So I saw that one before, during, and after, and it was a mess, but a wonderful mess, right? And I learned a lot of lessons then. So I actually interned at this weekend when I convinced a guy named Peter Sisson, who was hot at the time, and he still is hot. He's been a great serial entrepreneur, and he had raised a bunch of money from Jeff Bezos and Amazon and Kleiner Perkins to basically take wine and make it into the Starbucks of wine. It was called Wine Shopper. So in the fall of 2000, is this like whatever, that's 16 years ago, almost to the day, I convinced Peter to hire me to be an intern in the summer, of course. So I show up all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed on June 14th, 2000, right? And you have to keep in mind, I'd visited the warehouse in early March, before you guys remember what happened in March of 2000, anyone? What happened? Yeah, well, it peaked first, right? 5,000. The NASDAQ hit 5,000. The week before, my wife and I went up to see the warehouse in Napa. I've never seen so much wine in my life. I'm like, this is going to be the best thing ever. June 14th, I showed up, and I asked my boss, Chris Lang was his name. I said, hey, Chris, and we were going through the metrics of the company, and it was, you know, all these beautiful charts, and I said, hey, Chris, what are the units and the vertical units? Like, what are they? Are they thousands, tens of thousands? Like, just help me. And he's like, he's shaking his head. And long story short, those were actual units, like actual shipments. And I said to him, Chris, this is going to be a fun summer, isn't it? And I could ride my bike and deliver all that wine because it was all within San Francisco, probably all to the venture capitalists who were ordering wine from wineshopper.com. Anyway, what a disaster. Actually, I did catch up many years later, actually just last year, with Ted Schlein, who was the investor, and we had a good chuckle. He said that was his worst investment that he's ever made, Wine Shopper. So that was Wine Shopper, but we drank a lot of wine and had a great summer and went to a lot of pink slip parties. And then I came back after graduating because I'd been sponsored to go to Tuck by a consulting company. And I had plans, of course, of going right into tech, but the market had other plans for me. So I did a couple more years at consulting, promised myself I would do anything but big bank financial services, and then ended up, of course, at a big bank called HSBC in Monterey, California. I had been talking to this little startup at the time called Google. I wasn't sure if they were going to make it because they didn't have a business model. I think they turned out okay for Google. I did subsequently join the following year. I joined Google as an experiment. Sheryl Sandberg and Tim Armstrong basically ran sales and operations at the time, and they decided to put them together, and I was an experiment. I was the kind of first outside hire with a non-kind of sales background, and that was my first job at Google. I did that for a year, and I ran a region. We then started to verticalize, so I ran a vertical. You might detect it probably later if I have a beer in my hand. I am Canadian, So they sent me back to Canada to go fix Canada for Google. My California wife loved that. That was a joke. she grew to love it. We went up there for 3-4 years and had a great just a great time. That was probably the highlight of my career at Google. It was really took a country that was an afterthought, right? The that place up there to most Americans, right? In most countries, companies rather, and really took that from a couple hundred, several hundred million to $2 billion in revenue. Built an amazing team, an amazing culture, and it was there that I really, for the first time, perhaps thought I could really do some great general management things because I'd done it. It gave me confidence, and it really was just something I really enjoyed doing. So that taking that country and taking it into something that was a thriving business was really cool. But I did want to be back in California for professional reasons and certainly personal reasons. We have two lovely children, and we decided we wanted to raise them there. Although November 8th may change things, we may be making a boomerang back to Canada, but I won't go there. So I came back and I worked at something called Google X, which is the moonshot factory at Google. Sergey Brin runs it like his own personal R&D lab, and it's a fantastic collection of humans from all walks of life who have deep, deep domain expertise in the most obscure things, literally within a 12-foot radius from where I stood in my little cubicle. I had world-class people in physics, materials, branding, design, obviously computer software engineering, all within one building. So it was just a crazy collection of things. But deep down inside, I had this burning desire to basically do what I had in Canada. Right, I got spoiled up there, not because I love Canada, and I do, and some of my classmates are here, they can attest to that. I haven't lost that, by the way, in any way. But I really wanted to actually flex general management muscles. So I'd been approached by Sequoia Capital, which is a fantastic venture capital firm, many times over the years, and I was like really happy at Google, so they said, not now. But one of the things they mentioned was Evernote. And first of all, any Evernote, who's heard of Evernote? Okay, everyone, most everyone. Who uses Evernote? Okay, we got some work to do. Who pays for Evernote? Okay, yeah, that's about right. So we'll come back to that in a second. But when Sequoia came and said, hey, we've got this company called called Evernote. I'm like, yes, of course, I use the product. I love the product. And we're looking for a new CEO. And I was like, absolutely. And they gave me lots of other options. And I was like, no, like none of these others really float my boat. But Evernote, let's talk about that. A product I love, a mission that really matters in the world, right? To help people be more successful and productive, help them be more organized, an extension of one's brain. I really connect to that. I'm a bit of a productivity dork. So I decided to say, yes, let's have a conversation about this. The other thing, I used to drive by Evernote. It's on the 101, just south of where I lived. And I used to drive by it every day for about a year or two. And I was like, man, what are they doing? Like, they have such a great brand. And they seem to have lost their way, right? So this is a beautiful bag right here. I love it. I use it. We were selling backpacks and bags and pencil cup holders and socks, among other things. We'd also decided we're going to be a chat product at the time. I could go on. There's lots and lots of things that were going on at the company where I was just like, software is really hard. I know that. To layer on software and e-commerce and other things is impossible, right? So I felt like I could make an impact on a storied brand, on a mission that really mattered and resonated with me personally, and had a lot of the big, hard things already in place. Okay, so I joined about 14 months ago. It was late July in last summer, okay? So hopefully we can keep this interactive. So that's just the introductory part. I don't want to pull a shank or whatever and cold call on people unless I have to, I will. But I'll give you a sense as to the cards that I inherited, the hand that I was dealt. Because I knew it would be tricky. I knew it would be a tough one. Your first time CEO gigs always has hair on it, as they say. But this one had some particular challenges that I just want to lay on the table for you so you guys can kind of get into my skin. When I walked in August of 2015, and I had several moments of like, what have I gotten myself into? But so let's just lay them out. I won't go into too much detail, but you'll get a gist of this, right? I already talked about how we're unfocused, right, as a company, trying to do too many things and doing most of them kind of mediocre. We had about 12 to 18 months of runway, right, in terms of cash on hand. 12 to 18 months, that's not a lot. It wasn't a big deal when you can go and raise more money, but the funding environment, if you recall, I don't know, Phil, in last year for late stage, what was it like?
Oh, it was crazy until late last year.
Correct. Crazy until mid last year, and then everyone kind of, like, as tends to do, they backed away. Revenue was growing but not certainly for a venture-backed company, in the 20 to 30% range. So that's the bad. That's kind of the situation, right? Right. Limited runway, unfocused. Well, here's some other things. I'll just make it real fun, right? Eight-year-old company, 8-year-old product, right? Running your own data centers, lots of tech debt, a team that really had been there for a while and really had many of whom had joined because it was a hot unicorn. So Evernote was on the cover of Inc. magazine as the company of the year in 2013. That attracted a lot of buzz and a lot of attention from people who thought, "Hey, I want to be on this rocket ship." Okay, so that's the situation. So what would you guys do? Where would you start? Any volunteers? Where would you start? Yes.
Management team.
Okay, team, great. What else? Customers, tell me more. What would you do with customers?
Understand what's working, what's not. Why are they buying? Why are they not?
Good buying. So like revenue, I guess, and understanding customers. Okay. Okay, you guys are good. Others? Yeah.
Move to third-party services for cloud, AWS.
You guys have been like following the playbook, haven't you? Yeah. So like trying to figure out what you do and what you focus on and maybe what you can outsource. Okay. Others? Yeah.
Big product which is playing the same.
Who's that? What's that? Who? You mean Microsoft? Certainly. That's another part of this, right? So Evernote, a bit more of the history, and then I'll dive into some of these things because you guys got the big ones, right, as good Tuck students would do. When Evernote was started, so the history of Evernote is interesting. It was this guy, Stepan Pachikov. He's he literally, if you read his background, is like, he's like one of the most interesting men in the world kind of guys. Like, he's like a Russian entrepreneur, genius, created many, many companies. So some of the companies he's created were responsible for, like, today we'd call it machine learning, right? So training handwriting recognition to sort all the mail that the U.S. Postal Service does. So he was the person who created the technology that reads handwriting, all sorts of different handwriting, to sort it, as opposed to just doing it manually. This is Stepan. And other things too. So the Newton. Do you guys remember the Newton, the failed product by Apple? It was handwriting. It was his technology and his team that was behind that. This is the roots of Evernote. Stepan loves to tell stories. He loves to tell jokes, and he was starting to forget. Right? He had poor memory, and he's like, "That's a problem, right? I want to have an extension of my brain so I never forget anything." Right, and that's really the roots of this thing. And he also foresaw something interesting. About 10, 12 years ago, Palm Pilot and all these devices were starting to happen. 10 years ago, by the way, the iPhone didn't exist. Isn't that crazy? We think it's been here forever. Didn't exist, but he saw these things and he's like, "Oh, wow, information overload is overloading my brain. I can't remember things, and that's a problem. I want to recall things. And it's going to get worse. We're going to see an explosion of information." And boy, was he right. Right, so that's the roots of Evernote. So it was created to be an extension of your brain, to capture ideas, to nurture them, to hold on to them, because our brains aren't very good at remembering things. Right, so that was the genesis of it. And ultimately to make you more productive and successful, right? So you can recall information at just the right moment when you need it. So that's really the history of the company. And when companies get successful, sometimes they take on too many bets, right? So making people successful led to, okay, great. Well, people need backpacks and they need the office, like physical stuff. I'm like, okay, it's a bit of a stretch. But also this company called Slack had started to come on the scene a couple of years ago. And so we needed to be a chat product. So when you get success and you have infinite feeling like infinite resources in the form of venture back. And you have hubris. You kind of lean into things, and sometimes you can maybe stretch a little bit too thin. Okay, so what have we done, right? And there's a series of questions that some folks have asked. I'll get to those too. But if you guys want to just fire away throughout, that would be great too. I've made every mistake in the book when it comes to being a leader and a manager around teams, right? Like hired too slow, hired too fast, like made every mistake in the book. In fact, that was the one lesson I had from Canada. It was like, I didn't hire fast enough and didn't really think and prioritize the team. So was not gonna make that mistake. Absolutely, the team you build is the company you build, period, right? Period, nothing else matters really. Because like, especially in software, like people are building the software, right? Yeah, you can arm them with tools and so forth. So I literally, in the 14, 15 months I've been, it's 50 to 60% of my time as a CEO of the company. I personally, you can outsource everything but hiring, right? And I have been involved in almost every hire that we've made. We're starting to get to a point where folks are getting good because you have to keep the standards super, super high. And it's something that if you're looking to instill a certain character and a certain set of values in the company, you have to kind of own it yourself as a leader. I've hired an entirely new management team, right? We inherited some folks that were really keen to make this journey too, but you know, literally head of design, head of product, head of people, we had a CFO that predated me a couple months. I could go on, the whole leadership team is entirely new. And we had to do some pretty tough things. We basically focused our footprint geographically, focused our product roadmap and our portfolio, and made those decisions, and that led to some painful cuts. So we let some people go, right? So we've let a whole bunch of people go, and then we've hired back a whole bunch more people as well. So really, really focusing on teams, really articulating a set of values. So companies grow really quickly and they don't often step back and say, how do we want to work with each other? So we've spent a lot of time really talking openly about that. What's the company we want? And how do we develop a set of values that we can all live by? And that's a work in progress, but I'm really proud of that work. So the team, okay. Here's some other things, the good, right? I mentioned earlier the hard things that are in place for Evernote. This is an amazing company. So back then it was around 150, 160 million registered users. 150, 160 million registered users. We were acquiring and registering about 75,000 to 100,000 every single day, right? It's like kind of a mind-blowing number when you think about it. Close to 3 million new registered users every day, or every month, sorry. Global company. So Evernote operates in every single country and every single region in the world, including the Vatican, right? There's not a region in the world where we don't have users. But about 1% of people ultimately pay, right? And that's like, okay, when you get really, really, really big, like a billion or something, that might be interesting, but we're nowhere near that. So the next thing we started to look at was, okay, what's our business model like, and is it the right business model? So I'll come back to that in a sec. The other one was product, right? So quality. When you have a freemium business model, sometimes you can get away with or have the attitude that, you know, yeah, we want to have a great product, but you know, if someone's not paying for it, you know, you can kind of get away with a little bit of maybe slightly lower quality, and it doesn't work. So we've really, really radically improved the quality of the product as measured in things like the number of crashes or the number of times people, you know, call into the call center to basically, you know, register a complaint. So these are the sorts of things we've really invested in as well. Below the surface, under the hood, to make the product quality much, much better. And then actually leading to this notion that, hey, we don't need to do all these things. The world has changed a lot in the last 10 years, right? Maybe we can outsource things like the cloud, right? Like we had to do the cloud 10 years ago because there was no such thing as AWS. So we've made those types of decisions as well. But on the business model, we basically said, wow, we've got some of the most influential, actually affluent users in the world. They derive a lot of value from the service. We think it's probably fair that we don't just kind of throw it out there as a freemium, that we actually align the value we deliver into the world with a business model that says, hey, if you're getting that much value, maybe you should pay. So how do we go about that? We studied it quite aggressively for a couple months, and then we landed on access, like a Netflix type model. What I mean by that is a lot of people, the value that people derive most is the ability to capture these ideas anywhere and any time, and then recall those ideas, retrieve them at any time. Number of devices is a good proxy. So we decided to say, hey, if you're going to use a service on three or more devices, we're going to ask you to pay. Okay, we'll grandfather and do all those nice things, but that's how we did it. And yeah, I was not a very popular person on Twitter for a couple weeks. But, you know, we've done it, and people understand it, and you know, we've had great, great success. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a bit.
That's one of the a big challenge for a lot of companies when they're going through these types of transitions. Yeah. How do you actually make that palatable to customers that have maybe been with you for a significant period of time?
Yeah.
What was your sort of understanding approach, or have a sort of a target in mind that we're not okay, but we understand that there might be some shed of customers?
Yeah.
These are knowable problems, right? So you can use math, you can use simulations to basically understand and research. So we tested it all along the way. We used there's a little decision science stuff like that we brought into play, and we understood. We understood there's gonna be a trade-off of erosion of some of our user base. And without getting into the specifics, we thought it would be maybe low double-digit erosion, and then a 40-50% increase in revenues. When you really push on that, that's probably not a really tough decision for me, but it's a change. It's a change for the board, it's a change for the employees, and it's certainly a change for our users and our customers. So what we did in each of those constituents, we basically really, really opened and brought them into the process itself, right? With the board, right? You know, including the founder of the company, right? My predecessor, who have deep views on these sorts of things, right? And then a bunch of our investors. We brought them in early and often. We say, hey, this is the deal, right? This is the deal. These are the choices. These are the options. This is what I recommend as a CEO, but I want your input. So early and often, that was really important. With our employee base, right? A lot of them were like, well, this is different, right? This is not the company I signed up for. I'm like, hey, guys, same thing. This is the deal. These are our choices, right? We can go down this path right here. And I actually, for effect, I told a story. I'll get you in just a sec. Yeah. I said, you know what? People don't know why they're paying for the service, right? Other than they say they like it, right? I literally went to focus groups. I called customers myself. I had the analytics group pull like 50 or 60 names in some cells. And I just called them myself, and I just listened to them. And one of the themes was customers didn't understand why they were paying. Like, and then they would say things like, we just like you, and it's valuable, and it's a good service. I just like good services in the world. And like I said, this is one of the options I said to the team. I said, that's called a nonprofit, right? So like we can smack my ugly mug on a banner and be like Jimmy Wales at Wikipedia, or we can do like NPR and have like Pledge Week, right? Twice a week, three times a year. Like that's a choice, but just so you know, like, that wouldn't allow us to invest in, you know, free meals and a bus and all these things. So people didn't like it at first, but they got it. So we said, okay, what are we going to do? So that's how we started to socialize the concept. And with users, we're not bashful. We say, listen, we do something that is of great value. We think it's a premium service in the world, right? There are plenty of alternatives. There are plenty of crappy alternatives in the world. We're not one of them. You get what you pay for. There's no such thing as a free lunch. We're going to do this. We're going to expect, we're going to be very transparent about what we're asking. Our business is not about selling data. We do a service, a software service in the world. We deliver it to you. We expect you to pay if you derive a certain threshold of value. And you know what? Most people actually liked it. They said, wow, great. And they certainly voted with their feet in their pocketbooks, right? So now fast forward, we had our best quarter ever in Q3 on the backs of these changes. We talk about controlling your own destiny, right? So we now are at a point where I'm not worried about that, right? I'm not here to make an announcement about that, but let me just say, like, I'm not worried about the runway for the company. We have more than enough balance sheet cash to fund our investment as a company for the foreseeable future, which is really, really cool. So there's a question back there.
Yeah, so it's maybe backing up a little bit, but when you came in, did you think about what your potential exits were going to be? You mentioned you had some debt and mentioned you're an investor several times. So I just was wondering, did where you wanted to go in terms of an exit make an impact on the team and how you rebuilt the team to sort of position yourself on a trajectory to hit that exit?
Not really. The debt I mentioned, by the way, was tech debt. What that means is just like acquiring, making decisions, short or medium-term decisions to ship things. Very, very, very common, by the way. Like, speed matters more than anything when you're a company, right? Especially when you're a young company. If you're not fast, super fast, then you die. And so you accumulate tech debt by basically, you know, in the march to get speed. That's why I just want to clarify that. But you know, not in terms of exit, no. Like it's always in the back of your mind as an investor. But like, the short answer on that was Sequoia and the investors basically love the category. We have and had for sure a category leadership position. If you think about how great, awesome companies are made, they basically are category leaders in interesting categories. And the investors basically said, and that's why I was brought in, right? If they wanted to just flip the company and sell, they could have. They had plenty of offers, I'm sure. Me personally, like I was like, no, I want to. We're doing this thing, right? We're going to put in place the team. We're going to change the business model. Right, we're going to get this product quality up to the level it's going to be, and we're really make this a thriving the leader that we ought to be. Right, we've created this category, we have to be the leader. Right, other questions? Yeah.
So, do you have any IP on in terms of the product, and does that scare you that a bigger rival or competitor could come in and copy every new thing that you're doing and has a bigger user base to expand that service there?
Yeah, we have IP, probably like, I don't know, 70 or so patents. I mean, like, go back to the people who were like the software behind the Newton. I just have to be careful. Yeah, they're all Russians. Yeah, so they're all Russians. They're amazing mathematicians. And they understand, like, there was a name before machine learning. I think it's pattern matching or something. I don't know. They understand handwriting recognition better than anyone. So you can literally take a picture of a whiteboard or, I don't know, maybe a chalkboard. I haven't seen a chalkboard in a while. And you can read, like the software can read the handwriting, right? So we have tons of patents around that. There is, but it's interesting. Like our view on IP is it's like it's maybe defensive, right? Like what are we going to go and try and sue a bigger player? Like, no, like this is not, but we, from a defensive standpoint, we actually do think it's valuable to do that. Like you have to, like with competitors like that, you just have to go faster. You have to innovate. Like you have to delight your users, right? Like I could sit around, like I joke about the R&D thing. It's true, like it's absolutely true, but I could sit around and bellyache about it, but like the only way you're gonna win is actually to create a better product that delights more users, and that's what we're doing, right? So we're really tripling down on the notion of if you have an idea, you should capture it in Evernote as fast as you come up with that idea, or faster, right? So to think about that, right? You have an idea, there should be zero friction between the time you have that idea and get it into Evernote. So we're super, super excited about all sorts of machine learning things that can actually assist you in that journey, and that's one part of it. The other part is we've been a single player product, right? At a time when teams define any meaningful success or achievement in the world today. So one of the things we're placing a bet on is more collaborative features, right? A very busy market, very crowded market, but a big one and a growing one because especially with millennials coming into the workplace, right? People are bringing their own tools in. IT used to be the gatekeeper, right? It used to be five or six software packages and they had to be installed by IT. They had to be maintained by IT. Even in our small company, we have over 100 bits of software services that are bought. Someone pulled out their credit card, I'm sure, and just bought it. And that's at our company of like 300 people. There's just like 1,000 flowers blooming when it comes to software as a service and the ability to actually bring them in. So what I say, like productivity is personal, and it will be user chosen and company enabled. So we're making a pretty big bet on collaborative software as well, among other things. But the product strategy is evolving in a pretty fundamental way. as well.
How much of that is driven by opportunity and necessity from a business perspective versus customer demand? Or
yeah, that's a great one. Yeah, because the more nuanced thing is like, so 2 weeks ago, we had a great board meeting, best board meeting in 3 years, according to Stepan, the founder. He's an amazing guy. So I'm like, oh, I'm feeling really great about myself and the team, and woohoo, this is great. And I want to channel that. So we had a team all hands. We have an all hands every week, actually every other week now. In the time of transition, you cannot over communicate. It's physically impossible. It's impossibility. You have to communicate. You know, there's an expression I have, is like repetition doesn't spoil the prayer, right? You have to say things over and over and over and over again. And just when you think like you've said it too many times, you're halfway there. So like I really, really, really doubled down on communications. But anyway, 2 weeks ago, I was debriefing the board meeting, as I do. That's something I learned at Google. By the way, Google still does this. After every board meeting, the chairman of the board, Eric Schmidt, gives the board slides to the entire company. Kind of crazy, right? I'm talking about transparency. It's really cool. So I do that same thing. And here are the slides, right? Like, I mean, obviously, there's some things I can't share, but like 99% of them I can. And I said, this is great. Look at all the things we've accomplished, right? It's like the best quarter. You know, we basically had a cash flow positive month, and this quarter is looking up to be a cash flow positive quarter. Like, awesome. Like, we've got focus. We've got like all these. This is a long list of accomplishments. And I said, you know what? I'm proud of everyone, but this is strategic defense, right? This amounts to we played really good defense. And, you know, it's said that defense wins championships in sports. Not true in business. So I got some sad news for you, right? We need to go play offense, right? If we're going to win, you have to disrupt in business. You have to go fast, and you have to play offense better than anyone else. So that was what we did. And part of like the why should we do this, was the following. The following is basically our market, in terms of getting end users to pay, is probably going to reach a saturation point at some point here. Smartphone penetration. So R squared of smartphone penetration and growth and Evernote installation is like 0.7. Like, we see a massive amount of growth in Latin America, massive amount of growth in China and other places still. So it's crazy, right? People, this was one of the very first apps in the App Store, and people love it. It's a great companion for your smartphone. Shameless plug, you should use it. But your question about is a really important one. It's like the existing market, and we look at the competitors, as much as there's a lot of competitors, the market itself is growing, but not much, right? In terms of activity. People don't wake up in the morning and say, oh, wow, I need a new set of productivity software, right? This is not something that normally happens. I mean, usually when you install a device or you go back to school or in the new year, you basically say, oh, I need to commit to a new thing. Those are the moments when you think, but not every day. So it's not a huge growth category. At the same time, the problems that Stepan set out to solve are bigger and more audacious and crazy than ever, right? Information overload. We now have collaboration overload. I'm sure the students here see it, right? Like, they're basically being chat, text, email, all this stuff. Actually, kids probably don't use email anymore, right? But it's collaboration overload. So people are spending 80% of their time in meetings and in email and all those things. And like, it's crowding out the ability to actually do deep thinking. So that's interesting. And then, as I said, the teams, right? People are collaborating more, which is great. But the software and all these things don't talk to each other. So we basically said, hey, the choice of where we are today is not fantastic. And this market over here is growing, right? The software, the collaborative content software world, Microsoft has a $20 billion market. They sell $20 billion of Office. 5% of that's Office 365, and that portion's growing. And then if you look at just a slightly narrower slice of the market, it's about a $6 billion market. It's more collaborative in nature. So $6 billion growing at 20 to 30. That's a pretty decent market, and we think we can grow faster than that market and do really interesting things. So we say, hey, this is structurally a better market than ours. It's going to require different skills, but you know what? We have a head start. So one thing I haven't told you is 20% of our revenue is actually a product called Evernote Business, right? Where it's a different, slightly different product. It has slightly different features. We haven't really invested in it, and people are pulling that demand. They're basically saying to us, and the product has not been super, super invested in, but they're saying, hey, we want to use it in Teams. So we know that. We know that, and we're basically listening. We have a long list of things that we're knocking off a list of features, and then we have a long list of things we think can differentiate us. And again, what are those? Okay, we got a brand, right? We got distribution. We got people using it. We have tens of millions of people using the product every day in the world, three or more months out of 12, tens and tens of millions of people. So it's in their lives. It's just not really applied in this function. But we think we can help shape that. We have some talent, and also we have billions and billions of notes, which are relevant information. So everyone talks about machine learning and artificial intelligence, and that's great. That's a big person's game. That's the Apples and the Googles and the Amazons and the Apples and the Facebooks. But really, the tech is only one half of the picture. You need relevant data to fuel machine learning, or else it doesn't give you anything of value in your life. So we're sitting on top of 10 billion bits of information that is relevant by definition because that person put it into Evernote. So we think we can use machine learning to unlock some really interesting use cases for people that will truly make them like 20 and 30% more productive. So that's really what we're up to right now. And that's why. It's a mix of, hey, can't stay where you are, and this is an interesting market adjacent to where we are. Other questions? Yeah.
So I'm interested in getting back to sort of the cultural shift when you were coming in, and you know, you had differing views on approach from the founder, differing views on a lot of people who were there. So how, you know, you mentioned communication, but just what were some of the ways you kind of got people to come along with you, some of the battles you had to fight to really shift that culture?
Yeah, like nothing else matters than results, right? So you can communicate like a lot, and you know, I could pop up like about a month in. So I did a listening tour, and I just listened to everyone, like including the person who fed the fish, right, in the office. I just listened, and I said like, and I asked sweet questions. I say, what's you know, get to know people, of course, and that's important, and allow them to get to know me. What's working that we should double down on? What's not that we should stop? And then the third one is like, what's one thing that I should do? If you were me, what's one thing you would do? Not two, one. And then at the end of it, I said, I read out what I heard. And I do. It's a really good thing you should do. I think, I don't care what role you go into. When you go into a new role, like a lot of times, if not all the times in my experience, the answers are there. They're there. You just have to kind of unearth them and brush off a little bit of dust and then have the courage to basically say, no, it's these and not this. So I did a lot of that, and I distilled it. I called it the Evernote house, and I drew a picture of a house, and I said, well, like, what's the most important part of a house? What's the most important part?
Foundation.
Foundation. Okay, great. What's the foundation of a company? People. Yeah. People and values and culture. So I said, hey, guess what, guys? I'm going to spend over half my time, just so you know, I'm going to spend over half my time hiring. And this is after we just let a whole bunch of people go, right? They're like, is this guy crazy? I'm like, no, I meant it. We needed to basically triple down on hiring the right type of folks. And then we talked about, okay, great. Like, what's the roof? What's the North Star, right? What's the roof of the house? The house is why you exist as a company, right? So we went on a bit of an exploration, but it was really about connecting back to the original mission. Right, it's a very powerful mission to help be an extension of your brain, to help be more successful. Right, we believe in the infinite potential of ideas. Right? Everyone has an idea. I don't care where you are in the world. Everyone has an idea, and they need somewhere to capture it. You know what our real competition is? What's the real competition? A lot of you are using it right now. Right, right there. No, pen and paper. Right. Why do we do that? That's how you capture ideas. So really revisiting why we exist as a company, and then really retooling our product strategy to basically say, okay, great, how do we evolve from being this archive to being something that's more active, that takes these ideas, not just to capture them, but to turn them into something? This is where machine learning comes into play, right? We know more about people than they probably know themselves. We know more about our users, like should we choose, and we're really careful about these things, than Google does, right? The amount of stuff that our power users, people who use the product quite a bit, trust us with, tells us so much about those folks. And we want to use that in a very, very careful way, but to make people more successful. But to your point, yeah, communication. That buys you some time, maybe 6, maybe 12 months as a CEO coming into something like this. But results, right? Absolutely results, right? And the board's thrilled, not because, you know, I'm Canadian. They're thrilled because we've got a great team in place now, and we've got the results happening, right? And we've earned ourselves time and space to actually really, really go on the offense and really, really grow into that leadership position that we always, I think, should have as a company. Yes?
Just to follow up on this question, you mentioned hiring. You spend half of your time on hiring. What are some of the lessons you learned over your course of your career that you wouldn't have done like 10 years ago in terms of what you're looking for to build the foundation of the house, the qualities you're looking for people? Are you looking at more of their past record, their current performance, their potential, and how do you, you're new to the firm, and you may not be 100% sure about the culture of the future, then how do you sort of hire the people to align to a sort of uncertain future?
It's important. So I said a couple of things earlier, I'll just repeat a couple of them. Like, you can outsource everything but hiring. You have to get involved. It's just not something that's going to magically happen. You know, it's interesting, a lot of people think HR does hiring. That's garbage, right? I mean, they certainly play a big part. But no, the hiring manager does the hiring. So they scope out the spec, and they actively involved. There's a whole hiring ops, like, that needs to be great. Google's the best I've ever seen in the world, right? Just amazing, like, feedback. All the scheduling is just done so, so well. But some of the lessons I've learned is a lot of people hire for absence of weakness as opposed to presence of strength. And I think it's a big mistake, okay? Absence of weakness says, oh, well, you know, Joe is like, you know, kind of good, a couple, like, you know, kind of good at everything, right? And certainly not bad at anything. And that's wrong. You need to basically say, what are the two things that this role needs to be world class at? And hire for presence of those two things. So if you can't say this role has to be world class at these two things, and maybe it's three, maybe it's even just one, then I think you're failing as a leader in hiring that person, because you basically will have a bunch of kind of peanut buttered kind of average players, and that that's not a recipe for success. Sports teams are a good metaphor here, right? Like, literally, like, you need, like, what is a goal scorer in hockey? You need to, like, they need to score a goal. they need to have great hands. They need to have a great shot, right? And they need to be really, really fast. What are some of the other lessons? Oh, so the characteristics that I think just travel really well, like, in the theme, the folks that that are, you know, regardless of when they joined Evernote or any company I've been involved, they are connected to a mission. And it means something to them. I've never been in a company where people are like, "Yeah, I'm really excited to go make money," right? Like, as a mission, right? Like, with investment bankers, maybe notwithstanding. So having some element of mission driven is huge. Curiosity is a big one, right? I often say to folks, like, I want people who are going to solve tomorrow's problems, not today's. Because, like, I've given you a 14-month glimpse of what the heck I've been up to. Like, and that's like, you see the change that's happening in 14 months. Like, imagine that over multiple years. So you need to have people who are curious and interested in solving new problems. And then, like, this is one of the lessons from talk two. Is, like, be play well with others, right? Like, this is actually, I use that as part of our product strategy too, but as human beings, right? Like, be someone that you'd want to have in your study group, right? Those are the lessons that are hard. And I actually tend to not hire as much for what people have accomplished, but more for their potential, especially people earlier in their careers. Yeah, it's really important. And that's actually the secret of Google, by the way, like, is just hiring people young and early in their careers, and just, like, you know, letting them go and training them along the way, as opposed to bringing in a bunch of specialists. So,
other questions?
Yeah.
So I guess Evernote is still a young company, and you became as a new CEO. Do you have any plan to make the sustainable company as a long run, and what would your kind of strategy to build that kind of culture and strategy?
Yeah, it's interesting.
It's interesting. It's refreshing, actually, to get outside of Silicon Valley, because 8 years or 10 years is old in Silicon Valley. But I happen to agree that it's a young company. And yeah, so remember my metaphor about going from playing defense to offense? Like, the defense was, hey, the goal was to be a self-sustained company, to sustain. But the mission to make money, that's not very inspiring to people, right? People want to play offense. They want to disrupt. They want to see success. So absolutely, we now have a foundation from which we can build something fantastic and great and enduring. And I've touched on some of the elements of it, but absolutely, right? This is the path here is to be an independent company that is leading an important category, right? Like, in the world today, like today and tomorrow and yesterday, we think there's about 2 billion notes taken every day, right? Usually on pen and paper. So we think it's an enormous category, and everyone has ideas, and there's a need for this. So yeah, we want to create an enduring company. Again, that's back to our investors. Like, our investors are on the same page. They want us to create an enduring company. You know, a little bit of history on Sequoia and Roelof Botha, who's on our board and is amazing. You know, he was first money into YouTube. He invested in Instagram. He's on the board of Square, and he tells me stories. And these are first world Silicon Valley problems. But he feels quite strongly that he has sold a couple of these companies, have been part of companies that have sold too soon versus their full potential. And I think he feels the same way about Evernote, really. It's a potential to be an enduring company, a category leader in an important and growing category. Any other questions? I know you asked. Yes, over here.
You talk about disruption. So how much time is spent on like new features versus making the present feature more efficient? Because I read about Evernote Food and Evernote Hello and Peak, I think they are apps that are recently released and then shut down, I think.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
What kind of
it's a healthy mix between the two. But it's interesting. Making things easier to use, like while not new, is like the return on doing that when you have some degree of product market fit already generally outstrip the risk adjusted portfolio of new shiny new things, right? So we're not in cold fusion business, right? We're actually into making people more productive. So like, we need to basically help knowledge workers like students and consultants and bankers and, you know, people who use their minds for a living. We need to make them more productive and successful. So yeah, do we think there are some breakthroughs in there? Absolutely, right? We think it's all around machine learning and AI. But really, I'll tell you, of the 100, if it was 100 things that we could do, I'd say it's probably 60 or 70% in like, oh, how do we remove friction? For example, we're rebuilding our iOS application from pretty much the ground up. And I'm not typically a micromanager down to the level of like telling the teams what to focus on. In this case, I insisted on the optimization being time to content or time to note. So this is another thing I learned at Google was latency and speed matters, right? Amazon measures things in milliseconds. Google does the same because it matters. So time to note is one of the overarching design principles for our new iOS app, which hopefully will be coming out in a matter of weeks or months here. So yeah.
Yes?
The question on the pricing model and pricing change.
Yeah.
Can you share more about some of the methods and use to test different models?
Yeah.
Thinking about, or maybe, you know, contrasting that with Netflix and how Netflix kind of made a big change and had to, you know, almost apologize for it. They seem to not expect the reaction they got from their marketplace, but it seems like you guys are pretty on top of it.
Yeah, there's a whole range, and there's a lot of like German names, von Wurstenstorp models, I used to call them the VW model. The root of it is conjoint analysis that basically force choices and say, hey, like, you survey people, you ask open-ended questions, and then you use like some high-powered math of conjoint analysis. And then you basically take things and you survey them again. And what you'll find is people will say, oh my gosh, if you do this, I will like leave and you're horrible and you're terrible. And then you actually do a conjoint analysis and it's like, oh, well, yeah, no, that's not so bad. I'd choose you over here. I joke about that, but like literally you can measure the difference between those two things. And then what we did, we actually did a lot of focus groups. We said, okay, this is what we're thinking, what do you think? And we actually made changes as a result. So one example we were looking at number of devices and storage capacity, right? And what we found when we were trying to explain storage to people, even in Silicon Valley, people didn't really understand storage, right? Like, what is a megabyte? What is a gigabyte? Like, who know? I don't know. I don't even know what. One's bigger than the other. Like, great. But actually, more importantly, strategically, I did not want to be locked into a storage war. I didn't want someone to pull up the menu and say, "Oh, wow!" Like, you know that. So we actually removed that, and we just went and put it all on devices, and it turned out, in hindsight, to be a good move. But you know, you're dealing with such imperfect information, right? Just to drive me crazy when the teams would come back one week and the next week it'd be like, there's a different answer using the same methods. And I'm like, guys, like, can we dial this up, right? But it has to do with how you sample and how you weight things. And it's like, you know, I was okay at DXi, but not that great. So we hired some really great PhDs who really helped us. But as I think about it, like the things that I took away from here, this place, like the number one, two, and three is communication. Like there's not a, like, I don't know, there's not an hour in my day when I'm not communicating, right? Either like writing or talking or doing that. Decision science, the operations stuff. So actually the ops professors, I hope they're still as amazing as they once were. I mean, a lot of them gone on to be deans at different schools. But I'll never remember Professor Johnson used to end every class. He said, you know, we go through a high powered, like, you know, simulation and use math and all this stuff, simulating operations. Which has its benefits too, like Herbie. Like, I talk about Herbie a lot with the team. They still don't know what I'm talking about. But at the end of every class, he'd say, I think it's maybe Pike who said this. He'd say, but in the end, guys, it's all OB. OB is, of course, organizational behavior, and it basically means all about people. So all about people, Herbie. These are the things that I've taken away. And then, like, actually Keller's brand stuff. I always challenge the team to talk not only about the rational side of the brand, like the functional side, but the emotional side. When people talk about ideas and things and passions and desires they have in life, like, ideas are about as emotive as they get. So these are some of the things that are taken away. Was there another question? How are we doing?
If we're out of time,
you tell me, Patrick. I mean, I'm fine.
Yeah, okay.
So you talked about productivity and success for your customers sort of as a goal. So back to your sort of wine example, what are the units you guys think about? When you say we want our customers to be more successful or more productive, what are the sort of metrics or dimensions that you measure?
Yeah, so in a team construct, we're looking at, almost like an operations problem, it's like a production line. So ideas are sparks, and then they're collaborated on, and then they're turned into finished products. So we're looking at throughput through that. As a kind of meta level, but even less sexy or easier to measure things, like, are you using less email? Are you in less meetings? Right? These are the sorts of things that you can measure. And then there'll be motive ones, like, do you feel more organized? Do you feel more productive? So like, people spend 2.5 hours on average, knowledge workers, 2.5 hours looking for stuff. So we could actually ask them, like, are you spending more or less time? So we can instrument things too. So these are the sorts of things. I mean, so time spent looking for things, time wasted in meetings, emails sent, Slack messages avoided, all this stuff. So we're trying to instrument, especially in a team construct, these sorts of things. But anyways, yeah.
Another question, kind of just about your career overall, and specifically when you were still at X and were being recruited by Sequoia, kind of what made you stay at X as opposed to going to Sequoia?
Well, at Google in general, I just answer that question in a generalized way. Like, I think it's really important. So actually, one bit of advice I'll give to all you guys is, like, it's the best career advice I've ever been. So it's a friend of mine named Mike Steib, who's a friend and former colleague at Google. He and I were doing a career panel one time, and he's just so enlightened and so great, and I just felt like such a doofus next to him. I'd be like, yo, like, yeah, like, follow your passion or whatever. And he just has a really thoughtful way. So if just Google the Career Manifesto and Mike Steib. He's a CEO of a company called, what used to be called The Knot. I think it's called XO Group now. Anyway, look at that, because what most people fail to do, and I was one of these, like when you look at opportunities in your career, if you just take the inbound stuff, first of all, there's a lot of crap that comes to you. And second of all, if you don't have like a true north, or if you don't know like what's important to you, both personally and professionally, you'll end up just evaluating like one opportunity after the other and trying to trade those opportunities off each other, when in fact what you should be doing is having a pretty clear, almost like a brand, like what do you stand for, right? Like personally and professionally, and what are your goals in the next N years, and what are the things you need to shore up, both strengths that you need to build on and weaknesses you need to shore up. What are the opportunities in past? And it's the best, it's like a short read too, so this is the Career Manifesto. So to me, I had a pretty good sense of that, right, what I wanted to do, and Google in Canada gave me that, right? I was like, oh, I wanna maybe get that someday. The stuff I was trying to do at X was really take a lot of these innovations and bring them to market at scale. So look at the cars and Google Glass and wearables and these sorts of things. That was what I was trying to do, and I was trying to replicate what I had in Canada. So I felt like, wow, my opportunity to do that here is limited versus maybe going somewhere else at that time. And I did it against like, okay, how hard do I want to be working? You know, where do I want to be physically? You know, we all have our different definitions of what those things look like. So, but read that, and that'd be my one bit of advice to part on. But anyways, thank you guys so much. It's great to spend time.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Cool.